in Psalm 56, verses 8 to 13. And when you find your place there in that psalm, would you please stand with me this morning? Brother Joe, I'm getting a little bit of feedback. If you can help me with that one. Psalm 56, verses 8 to 13. And let's read these verses responsively. And I'll begin in verse 8, join verse 9, down to verse 13. The Bible says, "Thou tellest my wanderings, put thou my tears into thy bottle. Are they not in thy book? When I cry unto thee, then shall mine enemies turn back. This I know, for God is for me. In God will I praise his word, in the Lord will I praise his word. God, I put my trust. I will not be afraid what man can do unto me. Thy vows are upon me, O God. I will render praises unto thee. For thou hast delivered my soul from death. Wilt thou not deliver my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of the living?" Heavenly Father, thank you for this day and for this psalm that we are privileged to take a look at today. We thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for not only inspiring your word, but, Lord, for preserving it for us and, Lord, keeping it so that we could have a copy of it and read it and understand it in our own language. We thank you, Lord, for the miracle of the Bible. We just today, as we consider these words, Lord, may they be light to us and a light to our path. And, Lord, may we hide these words in our heart that we might not sin against God. We thank you for giving us your word, for giving us your son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and Lord, for eternal life through faith in him. Lord, as Brother Matt prayed already this morning, if there's anybody among us that does not know Jesus Christ as his or her Savior, I pray that they'd realize that what you are looking for is not a religious experience or a religious practice, but rather you're looking for what they will do with the Lord Jesus Christ. If they would receive him as their Savior, you would forgive their sins and become their father and secure for them a home in heaven. Lord, please, I just pray that, Lord, if there's anybody that does not have a personal relationship with Christ, that today would be that day. Lord, we love you and just pray that you would help us to be challenged, convicted, changed, comforted, whatever the case may be today, by the preaching and teaching and the receiving and the hearing and doing of your word. For we ask it all in Jesus' precious name and for his sake. Amen. And you may be seated. It's a very interesting psalm here. My Bible says in the description of this psalm, this psalm was given when the Philistines took David in Gath. Obviously, David was a man of war. David's life was a very interesting life. He was the youngest of his brothers. He came to fame or rose to a place of fame when he fought the giant Goliath on the battlefield and won the victory for Israel that day after the giant Goliath had held off the armies of Israel from entering into battle for a number of days. And so David was the one out there and became the champion of the Lord's armies in that day when he went out to face Goliath with a slingshot and the bag of rocks. Five rocks he had, amen. Why five? In case he missed the first four times? No. Goliath had four brothers, amen. And they did carry on blood feuds back then. And if you went after somebody's family, their family kept coming after you until they were dead. So David knew what he was getting into that way. David, from that point on, as Saul became jealous of him, David became a fugitive in his own country and had to flee from his own family even and was chased by the king of the people, of his people, out into the wilderness and began to flee from Saul. But while he's fleeing from Saul, he also had to flee from the Philistines. And so he really found no rest for his head and was a fugitive in his own land. Even after Saul and Jonathan had died in battle against the Philistines and David was made king, the battles never stopped for him. He was in battle with the Philistines, battle with the Edomites and many other neighboring countries there. So he knew what war was like. And so David was on the run quite often. In this case, and the occasion of the psalm is when the Philistines took him in Gath. There were times when David was in battle that the battle's outcome was in doubt, and this certainly was one of those. And so David finds himself in a strait, and certainly in some difficult times. And I want to just take you through the psalm a little bit. Our interest is in verse 8 to the end of the into the end of the psalm. But the first seven verses, if I could just sum them up this way, David is taking an interest or making an inspection of his current or present situation. He's in battle. The odds don't look very good. The outcome is in doubt, and David pours his heart out to the Lord as he inspects his current or present situation. And when David looks at that, he says this, be merciful unto me, O God, for man would swallow me up. He fighting daily oppresseth me. Mine enemies would daily swallow me up, for they be many that fight against me, O thou most high. What time I am afraid, I will trust in thee. In God I will praise his word. In God I have put my trust. I will not fear what flesh can do unto me. Every day they wrest my words. All their thoughts are against me for evil. They gather themselves together. They hide themselves. They mark my steps when they wait for my soul. Shall they escape by iniquity? In thine anger, cast down the people, O God. As we go through these words, and again, very briefly go through these words, it's not the intent of our sermon this morning, but as we go through these words, and as David inspects where he's at and takes an interest in his present situation, he finds out that his present situation isn't an unfavorable one. He finds out that his present situation is an unpleasant one. He finds out that what he's dealing with at that time is a very unwanted set of circumstances. As he takes a look around him, he finds out that the enemies that are arrayed against him are unyielding. They are daily after him. You say, Pastor Ross, what are we trying to get at here? The Christian life is not a life free from harm. It's not a life free from setbacks. It's not a life free from fightings. It's not a life free from those situations that we would find unpalatable. Often, many times, and many times throughout the day, we find ourselves in situations that are not really to our liking. As a matter of fact, as I go through each day, I find out that there are very few days that are just the way that I want them. I mean, God's not some divine waiter up there saying, now, okay, Bob, what do you want for today? Okay, you want sunshine, you want 70 degrees, you want all the green lights when you come to the intersections. He's not taking my order today. There are things that I'm going to have to contend with, things that I'm going to deal with, things that I'm going to run into that are going to be opposed to me or that are going to be contrary to how I would like them. And let me just say this. It's not because God is not good, but God is divine. God is sovereign. He knows exactly what I need to face in order to grow in my faith and to please Him. I was yesterday had the privilege of conducting a memorial service for Brother Bud's brother that recently passed away, and I took the folks in the sermon and ran them to John chapter 11, where Lazarus passed away, and the reason that Jesus Christ gave for not coming when he was notified of Lazarus' sickness until Lazarus had died, he said, I did this to the intent that you might believe. To increase their faith, to help them to understand that their faith placed in Jesus Christ was a valid faith, was a secure faith. And so sometimes God, like he did in David's life, allows us to fight battles or go through trials or face obstacles that are not very pleasant to deal with. But it's in those times of struggle that God shows himself mighty, and it's at those times of struggles when we find out that our faith is a valid faith when it's placed in Almighty God. If our faith was never tested, we would not know its worth. And I stand here today saying God's good. Why? Because I've been in some times that weren't so good, but God showed himself good in those times. And guess what? I can stand on the other side of those valleys, the other side of those fights, the other side of those tears, and say, you know what? God was with me the whole way. It might not have been pleasant. It might not have been something that I wanted to happen, but I'll tell you what, God's good. I'm thinking of situation after situation where the tears were coming down, where the frustrations were mounting, where the enemy seemed to be getting the last laugh and things. Well, you know, and just trusting God and not understanding it, but just trusting Him. God brought me through, and I stand here today saying God's good. And we see this borne out in the life of David. So as he inspects his current situation, well, I'll tell you what, doesn't look very good for David. God's going to have to intervene if David's going to escape. And let me just say this. God's a very present help in time of trouble. He is good. He's a good resource. He's a good one to place our trust in, the best, I'll say it that way. But as we go through our text this morning, there are two things I really wanted to pull out of this psalm to be a help this morning, to be an encouragement this morning. But the first thing that we see that I saw when I was reading through here that spoke to my heart was the interest that God has in His people. He allows us to go through some times and situations and circumstances that are not pleasant. But God, in those times of difficulty, still has a divine interest in us. If you're here this morning, guess what? The moment that you asked Jesus Christ to be your Savior was the moment that God became your Father. I say, what? Pastor Ross, God's not the Father of all mankind. No, God's the Creator of all mankind. He does not become a divine or heavenly Father until that moment of faith. How do you know that? John chapter 1, the Bible says, but as many as received Him, to them gave He power or the privilege to become the sons of God. So it's not until a person places their faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ that they become a child of God. And as a child of God, guess what? He takes an interest in us, a divine interest. And some of these things are borne out. This is not exhaustive by any stretch of the imagination, but there are several things mentioned in this psalm that I think are worth noting. What kind of interest does God take in His children? He takes, first of all, an interest in their traveling. Look at verse number 8. Thou tellest my wanderings. He cares about where you're going. He cares about where you've been and where you're going, where you're at right now. So the journey that you're on, guess what, is not unknown to God, and He takes an interest in that journey. Matter of fact, he kind of maps it out for us too. Thou tellest my warnings. That word tellest there means that he marks or records it. He knows what we're going through. Say, Pastor Ross, why is that important? Because of his divine love for us. So the Bible says he tells my wanderings. He marks our path and records the things we've gone through. The Bible says in Psalm 37, verse 23, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Again, that word order there means they're confirmed or established. God not only marks them, but God lays them out for the good man, the one that wants to follow him. The psalmist said in Psalm 139, verse 3, thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways. God takes an interest in where you're going. Amen? God hasn't forgotten where you've come from or what you've been through. God, let me just say this. God knows all the burdens you're carrying around today. He's watched the path that you've been walking this week. He knows all the trials that you've had to endure, all the struggles that you've had to engage in, all the tears that you've shed. I mean, he's interested in your path. Amen? And not just your path, past path, your present path, what you're engaged in right now, and what you're going to go forward into the future to face. We've got a God that's interested in our travels and what we've gone through. Not only interested in our traveling, but the Bible says he's interested in our tears. Verse number 8 again. Put thou my tears into thy bottle, are they not in thy book? Probably one of the most comforting words in the Bible. God knows when we're shedding tears. Whether those tears are tears of frustration, tears of sadness, tears of loss, I mean, whatever they are, God captures those tears. The psalmist asked him to capture those tears and write them down in his book. Just like God has marked down our travelings, God has also marked down the reasons for our tears. There's not a tear that you've ever shed that's been secret to God. There's not a time of mourning or a time of loss that's ever escaped God's divine attention. I'm glad God takes an interest in us. I'm glad that God doesn't just pay attention in us or to us when we're doing well and things are great, but I'm glad that God has got his eyes upon us and is attentive to us and takes an interest in us even when things aren't going very well. He's interested in our traveling. He's interested in our tears. He's also interested in our thoughts. I like what the psalmist said in Psalm 139. Also, he said in verse number 1, he said, O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my downsitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. He's paying attention to us. He knows what we're thinking. That's a scary thought. You know, really, nobody else can know what we're thinking unless we open our mouth and tell them. But God knows what's rattling around up there. Sometimes my thoughts are like wandering, just wandering lonesome people up there. Amen. Just all by themselves. Amen. But God knows those thoughts. He even says about our thoughts and gives us a little insight to how he takes an interest in us. And we find this in Malachi chapter number 3, verse 16. The Bible says, then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written for before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. God is not only journaling down the reason for our tears and capturing our tears in his bottle, but every time we think about him, guess what? God's journaling that down as well and writing that down in a book called A Book of Remembrance. I taught the young people in chapel a couple weeks ago about this, and God's recording all the time we think about him, but also all the time that we engage in conversation about him. If we think about that, it's a little convicting, amen? How full is that book of remembrance for us today? I'm afraid when some people get to heaven and God pulls that book of remembrance off the shelf, it's going to be a book full of blank pages. Or maybe just a couple thoughts written in there. I don't want my book, that book of remembrance, when God pulls it off the shelf and shows it to me, just to be a very thin, light volume. I'd like it to be full. I'd like to have my own wing in heaven, amen. That library, amen. Okay, Ross, we got to back the truck up and pull these out. Here's all the times you thought about me. Here's all the times you talked about me. You say, Pastor Ross, you've got an advantage. You're a preacher. Yes, I do, amen. And so I get to talk about him an awful lot. So you'll forgive me there. But again, we ought to be spending our time thinking about him and talking about him. He ought not to be very far from our thoughts at all. And certainly, he ought to be a ready answer off of our tongue, amen, as we give a reason for the hope that's within us, amen. So we ought to be ready to talk about the Lord. You know, I like talking about sports. I watch sports. I talk about sports, talk about weather, talk about the politics, talk about history, talk about this, that. But I'll tell you what, there's one subject that I ought to be primed and waiting to talk about, and that's him. He knows our thoughts and is journaling those things down, and the words that leave our lips about him are being written down. God, let me just say this morning. You came in here today. God takes an interest in every decision you're going to make today. Every step that you take, guess what? He's numbered it. Every hair on your head is numbered as well. Again, I'm just trying to do God more favors by losing as much as I can. Amen. Just trying to take a little weight off God being God. Amen. But he takes that kind of interest in us. That's an awesome thing. When you consider the grandness of this universe and the majesty of all that's around us, that God would take an interest in us and such an intense and specific interest in us, that's an awesome thing. That encourages me. So, Pastor Ross, not too many people know my name. Not too many people care about me. I can't speak to that, but I'll tell you what, I do know one that cares about you. I do know one that thinks about you. I know one that takes an interest in you more than anybody else ever could, and that's your Heavenly Father, amen? And I don't know how many folks are going to show up at my funeral, whenever that might be, amen? It really doesn't matter. I'm dead anyway. But I know that God's taking an interest in me. And with that thought, I can walk on. I might be forgotten. I might run into people that used to know me that have forgotten my name and everything. That's fine, but God's never forgotten my name. God knows exactly who you are today. You might not be popular. You might not know a lot of people. A lot of people might not know you, but that really doesn't much matter. God knows who you are, knows what you're going through, knows what you've been thinking, knows what you've been talking about. He knows where you've been, and he knows the tears that you've shed. So I think the interest that God takes in his people is a pretty incredible thing that ought to comfort us. It ought to challenge us to think more about him. And that's where I'm going with the next point here. Not only do we see in this psalm and these verses the interest that God has in his people, but we also see the interest that the people, his people, ought to have in their God. It's a two-way street. Is it fair that God would spend and invest so much time thinking about us and being interested in us and we not return the favor, having an interest in the things of heaven? I think that's pretty selfish. You think about relationships that you've enjoyed in life. What are the most satisfying relationships? The one where it's one-sided, where you're doing all the work? Or is it when those actions are reciprocated? If you're investing all the work and all the attention and all the effort, I guess, in the relationship, and it's not returned, you get a little tired of it after a while, don't you? You wonder if it's worth the effort. I wonder how God feels about us. I know God's not man. I know his ways are higher than our ways and his thoughts are higher than our thoughts, but he's shown us in the Word of God and put down in the Word of God all the interest that he has in us, and we can't even really touch on that, but he takes a great interest in us. What kind of interest are we taking in him? I tell you, the psalmist really brought this into focus, or the what David was going through here really brought this into focus as he thought about how important God was to him. Why? Because the heat was on. The struggle was in front of him. I mean, he's almost captured by the Philistines, and he needed divine help, and guess what? So his attention turned toward heaven. Can I say this? I think it's great in our times of trouble that we ought to turn our thoughts toward heaven. But can I say not only during our times of trouble, but also during our good times? Should we turn our attention toward heaven and be willing to think about him and spend some time investing in what we know about God? So there should be an interest of his people in their God. What are some of these things we see from David's own pen? Well, he says in verse number 9, "When I cry unto thee, then shall my enemies turn back." We see that the interest of God's people in their God, we ought to have an interest in God as our security and our refuge. "When I cry unto thee, then shall my enemies turn back." Oh, that's interesting. Think about this. Parents, when you have children, and maybe the little one picks on an older one, and that little one would run behind you so the older one couldn't get at him. That's kind of the image that David's giving us here. When I run to the Lord, guess what? My enemies turn back. They know that they can't get at me. Why? Because my protector's here. Making sense there? When I turn to God, guess what? It doesn't matter how many enemies I've got, how great they might be. They can't approach unto me. They have no power to hurt me. Why? Because my God is greater than them. So he said, I've got an interest in my God. Why? Because of the security he provides for me and the refuge that he is to me. When I cry to God, they then shall my enemies turn back. They've got no place there. They cannot and will not enter. Why? Because God is for me. The writer of Proverbs says this in Proverbs 18:10. "The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runneth into it and is safe." We might call that a secure place, a safe place. We run there, and guess what? No evil can harm us there. Why? Because we're in God, and we're behind God's divine protection there. I like that, amen? I like knowing I can run to God, and no harm will befall me there. God is good, amen? Not only do we have, we see that, that God is a security and a refuge for us, but he also makes a statement in verse number 9, "For God is for me." I'm on the right side of the equation. I'm on the right team. Dan, I think a week or two ago, led us in singing, "I'm on the winning side." Well, when you're on God's side, you're always on the winning side. That doesn't mean every battle is going to roll our way, but I'll tell you what, in the grand scheme of things, we know who wins ultimately, and we know we're on the right side of things. Paul said this way in Romans 8:31. "What shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?" It's kind of a rhetorical question. If God's on your side, you really don't need to worry about who's lining up on the other side. Amen. Because you've got the winning one on your side. I'm glad that God loves me. I'm glad that Christ died for me. I'm glad that I'm one of God's children. And as one of God's children, guess what? My interest in God allows me to examine the security He provides for me and the refuge that He is to me when I need help. David also mentions that the interest in the child of God and their God ought to lend us to examining God as our resource of substance in our life. First of all, the substance of our praise. Look at verse number 10 again real quickly. David says this, "In God will I praise His word. In the Lord will I praise His word." If you look at that, you say, "Pastor Ross, is he stuttering there? In God will I praise His word, in the Lord will I praise His word." He's saying the same thing, repeating himself. Is he stuttering? No, he's not stuttering there. In that first phrase, in God, that word God there means Elohim. That means a name belonging to God as a judge. And then he goes on to say, in the Lord will I praise His word. The second word there, Lord, is Jehovah. It's a name of mercy. What is David trying to get at here? Well, he says, whether I am viewing God or being treated by God as my judge and He's correcting me, I'm going to praise Him. And if God is showing mercy to me by delivering me, guess what? I'm going to praise Him just the same. So it doesn't matter what's going on in my life. I'm just going to get in that position of praising God. Too many of us are geared this way. We're only willing to praise God when things are going well, when things are going our way. David said just the opposite. He said, you know what? If God's my judge and God's allowing correction to come my way, or God's allowing trials to come into my life, or God's allowing me to shed tears, guess what? I'm still going to praise God. He's good. But if God deliver me from these Philistines and God put me on that mountaintop, and guess what? And the sun shines through, guess what? I'm going to praise Him there too. We've got to get into that mindset that God's good no matter what's going on. God's good all the time, and God's good for now and forevermore. And so David said, He's the resource of my rejoicing. I can rejoice in who God is, amen? He's my Father, my God, as they sang today. He's the one that redeems us. He's our Redeemer. He's the one that bought us back from sin. He's our Savior. He's our peace. I mean, He's our High Priest. I mean, all these things God is to us, we can praise His name regardless of our situation. So He's the substance of our praise. Charles Haddon Spurgeon put it this way. He said, I will praise God. And he commented on this verse. He said, I will praise God whether He deal with me in a way of justice or in a way of mercy. When He hath thunder in His voice as well as when He hath honey under His tongue. He said, I'm just going to praise Him. Amen. Doesn't matter how I meet Him or what the day brings forth. I'm just going to be in that position of praise. So David's looking at the Lord and taking an interest in the Lord as his refuge and security. Also as his substance for praise. Also his substance of trust. Look with me at verse number 11. In God have I put my trust. I will not be afraid what man can do unto me. So his trust is in God. Isaiah said this way, the great prophet in the Old Testament, he said, behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He has also become my salvation. Who is God to you? I think to a lot of people, and it's a little frightening, that to them God's just some spiritual Santa Claus. That we wait to open up the goodie bag and drop goodies upon us whenever we ask for Him. That's not God. Some treat Him like that. Some treat Him like some spiritual genie. You know, we rub the old King James a couple times, amen, and, you know, God, pop out and grant me my three wishes. God's not like that. See, we expect God. We appreciate God when the blessings are flowing. We appreciate God when everything's going well for us, but I think the time to appreciate God and His glory and His grace and His mercy and all the good things He brings into our life, our reason to praise, are more magnified in our down times than they are in our up times. Can I remind you that David was writing this psalm not in a very pleasant position? Not as a general that just won great victories, but rather as somebody that's trying to save his own neck through this battle that he's encountering right now? The end of the battle is still in doubt, but yet what is David doing? I'm going to praise God. He's my refuge and my strength, my security. He's the source of my praise. I put my trust in Him. What's David saying? I'll use a little phrase here, and it's not really a good translation of this, but he's put all of his eggs in one basket, and that basket's God. Amen. If I go down, guess what? I'm going down with God. He wasn't hedging his bets. He wasn't half in, half out. He wasn't saying, well, I'm going to trust in God in my sword. I'm going to trust in God in my spear. I'm going to trust in God in my chariots. I'm going to trust in God in my ability to wage war. No, I'm just going to trust in God, amen, and allow Him to carry me through. His confidence was in His God. Amen. Where's your confidence at today? Is your confidence in your bank account? It's not a good place to place your confidence. Your confidence in your abilities, your confidence in your attainments in this life, your confidence in your popularity. What are you placing your confidence in today? But if it's not the Lord, you're on shaky ground, you're on sinking sand. David said, Philistines look like he got the upper hand right now, but my confidence is still in God, and so guess what? I'm just going to keep trusting him. In God, if I put my trust, I will not be afraid what man can do unto me. Everything's okay. Why? Because God is my trust. David looked at God not only as his substance of praise, his substance of his trust, but also his substance of his honor toward his God, or that he was worthy of the honor that he could afford to him. Look at verse number 12. Thy vows are upon me, O God. I will render praises unto thee. For thou hast delivered my soul from death. Wilt not thou deliver my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of the living? Verse number 12, he said, God is worthy of the honor that I bestowed upon him. What's going on here? He said, God, thy vows are upon me. I'll render praises unto thee. He made God a promise in his tough times, and he was going to carry through on that promise. And what was that promise he made to God? God, if you'll take care of me, I'm just going to praise you. Seems like a simple thing, but I'll tell you what, the flesh doesn't like to praise God. Doesn't like to give credit to God. Hey, let me just challenge you this way. You get a promotion at work, and tell people that you got the promotion because God saw fit to give it to you. Give him the credit for it. How willing is our flesh to say, well, you know, God did it for me. God brought it down. I mean, tell that to somebody who doesn't go to church with you. See how your flesh wants to respond that way. David was saying, as a man of war, he said, everybody's out on the battlefield. I'm not sure how this is going to turn out, but I'll tell you what, I put my trust in God. God is going to be the one that gets us out of this. And he put his full confidence, his full weight and confidence on Almighty God. So his trust was in the Lord. His honor then was to obey that vow that he made to God. God, if you'll get me through this, if you'll take care of me, then God, I will do what I told you I would do. So let me just say this. God has got no pleasure in them that make vows to him that don't carry through on those vows to him. How many times have you heard people saying, God, if you just get me out of this just this one time, then I will, well, then we better, when he gets us out, right? That's David. God, you saw me in this. I made a promise, made a pledge, I made a vow. God, guess what? You are honorable and you're worthy of me carrying through on this vow. The sacrifices of praise and thanksgiving to the Lord that he had promised in distress, he had vowed and promised that if the Lord would deliver him, he would praise his name and give him all the glory. And he now, David does, resolves to fulfill that which he had promised. And lastly, what do we see going on here? We see that God to David and God to his children ought to be that source of our daily guidance. He says in verse number 13, to finish it off, wilt thou not deliver my feet from falling, that I may walk before God in the light of the living? God is a source of strength for my day-to-day living. When Jesus Christ taught us how to pray, he gave the pattern for prayer this way. He said, after this manner therefore pray, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. He didn't give us those words to repeat, but he just gave us a pattern to pray. Part of that prayer that he taught us, that pattern for prayer that he taught us there, that he taught the disciples there, was give us this day our daily bread. It was a daily walk that he was encouraging us in. We need God every day. We don't need just God one day a week. We need God tomorrow too. I've noticed that most of my problems don't happen just on Sundays. Amen. Most of my struggles don't just take place on Sundays. Amen. When I'm in church. They take place on Tuesdays and Wednesdays and Thursdays and Fridays and Saturdays and every other day. Amen. There's only a couple of other ones after that, right? I need to be with him daily, day after day after day. And so we see that David is yielding to God and asking God for daily guidance. God, I want to walk before you in the light of the living. God, I want to walk before you daily, walk before you moment by moment. I don't want to just put you in a box or confine you to one day a week, but God, I want this walk to be something continual. I want this walk to be something that's pleasing to you. I want this walk to be something that is beneficial for me. But Lord, I want you to deliver me, my feet from falling, so I can continue to walk with you and before you day by day. So that daily guidance is what he was thanking God for his pledge to God and realizing that God was the one that was going to keep him on the path day after day. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not on thine own understanding, and all thy ways acknowledge him. He shall direct thy paths. It's a daily path that we walk on. It's not just a Sunday jog. It's a day-by-day journey with God. The sooner we realize that, the more effectively we realize that, guess what? We can walk with God day by day. What's going on in this psalm here? We see David faced with some very unpleasant circumstances. But we see that David, as he's enveloped in his unpleasant circumstances, we see that David takes note of God's interest in him. We also see that David's heart moves him to take an interest in his God. Hey, we're going to deal with some things this week we're not going to like. Maybe there's going to be some tears in our week. I don't know. There's going to be some frustrations we're going to deal with. Can we all agree on that? When those frustrations come upon us, let's do something. Let's make sure we're taking an interest in our divine, in God, because we know that He's taking a divine interest in us. Let's, as we go through the trials this week and the struggles and some of the challenges that this week's going to bring forth, let's not forget that God's got an interest in us, a big investment He's made in us. Pastor Ross, He that spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how shall not freely with Him freely give us all things? God has already made the biggest investment. He yielded, He gave His Son for us. Through His Son, He can give us all things that we need. So God's taken a divine interest in us. Let us take a great interest in Him as we go through. And we'll find, guess what? Those challenges aren't so big to God. I've said this a number of different ways over the years and in many different words. But when we face these challenges and these struggles and these heartaches and tears and the turmoils that sometimes get thrown away or spread across our path, instead of magnifying those things that are in opposition to us or frustrating to us or unpleasant to us, instead of magnifying those things, let's magnify our God, great God. What we know about God to be true, His interest in us and the return interest that we ought to have in Him as well. You've got a great God. Don't leave Him here today. Don't leave Him at 101-5 Lowry Avenue. Take Him with you. Amen. Because I tell you what, you've never left His sight, never left His mind, never left His attention. Let's keep our eyes fixed on the Son and find victory to help in time of need.